Hello everyone. Hola. Thanks for attending this session. So my name is Pramod Bandiwat, and I have my colleague Saurabh Gupta. So today we'll talk about dynamic over-provisioning. Before we start, I just wanted to tell you where we come from. So we work for Tata Communications. Tata Communications operates OpenStack-based clouds in 9 locations across the globe. Primarily, our customers come from APAC and Europe, and most of the time, our target customers are enterprises who are just moving on to the cloud. So either they come from a dedicated setup, and then they want to move their workloads onto cloud, or there are these guys are already existing VMware customers who would want to migrate to OpenStack because of the self-service capabilities and the other wonderful features which OpenStack provides. So when we migrate these customers, they have a different set of expectations. They usually expect some enterprise-grade features which are already available with VMware, and also they would have done some things in terms of clustering and all on a dedicated setup, which they kind of expect those features to be available from the platform. And these apps are not cloud native by nature, so that's why we'll have to we make a conscious effort to give them those minimum set of enterprise features which will keep their workloads available, and then which will meet the peak demands and the varying patterns of their workloads. So last time around, we did a talk at Austin Summit, which was to do with instance HA. We showed what had to be done when a compute node goes down. This is in continuation with that project, where we've seen issues in our deployments where we couldn't meet some peak demands. We couldn't onboard new tenants because we didn't have enough capacity. Although the utilization showed that the resources were unused, there were still idle resources available, but we couldn't onboard new customers. We saw that there was fragmented systems lying around, and then setting these over provisioning ratios didn't help because of the way the hardware resources are being allocated to OpenStack is pretty static. Although there is horizontal scaling available, but it has its own costs associated. So we'll tell you what we have done to overcome this problem, how we have tried to get to a state where we have utilized our systems optimally without impacting performance. But a word of caution here is this may not be a very generic solution, may not be suitable for all kinds of workloads out there. But that's how it goes. We try to solve a specific problem to a specific set of customers, and then live with it. So today, to get started, we'll talk about. So this is how the flow goes. We'll talk about provisioning resources in OpenStack, how the resources are being currently provisioned. We'll just quickly go through what are the challenges with the current approaches. And then, so what are the different kinds of compute patterns we have seen, and which are generally diverse set of patterns which the cloud workloads are characterized as, and then why we need to change to a static over-provisioning, from static over-provisioning to a dynamic performance-based provisioning. So at the end of the presentation, we'll see that we are not actually over provisioning, but we are right sizing and we are optimally using the resources there. And then what are the considerations for dynamic provisioning? We'll see the different resources, VMs, and the groups of resources which we need to consider, what actions, what monitoring we have to do, and then what we have done out of those considerations. And then we'll talk about a design architecture, then we'll see what changes we've done. We've tried not to make any disruptive changes. We've used the already available features which were there with hypervisors, and then we've just bridged, we've just connected the dots together and then built the solution. And then we'll show you a quick demo on a couple of the features which we have done. Then the feature development key takeaways and then the references. So the current provisioning, how do you over-provision in OpenStack right now is you go to nomura.conf and you set the CPU allocation ratios. These are the default set of values, and then this assumes that over the so if you set this on a scheduler, all the compute nodes will have to adhere to this. And then if you want to change this dynamically, you'll have to restart services and whatnot. So this might not be suitable for everything. Again, so there are ways they can just still go and set this in individual compute nodes where compute services are running. And then any change to these values requires restarts. So to an instance, you use flavors. And then it assumes that over a VM's life cycle, the flavor is, the flavor size are enough. So generally, what do we end up providing more resources than required? We go to the upper ceiling and then say you might require these resources. That results in underutilized systems. And then we have quotas. So we have quotas for tenants, which when onboarding a tenant, we set those fixed quotas, and then we assume that these are not going to change for the VMs for those tenants over its lifetime. So this is again a static setting. So the challenges with these techniques, workload patterns vary. The flavors, what we associate with a VM, are very inflexible. We don't have a scope to resize the flavors without disrupting the workloads. And then, as usual, the performance requirements drastically vary depending on the time of usage, depending on the SLA, and its performance tier. And then there's no easy way to predict the workload patterns. There are softwares out there which will give you an indication of how the workloads might behave, but there's nothing available which you can readily use. And then we have underutilization of resources. We end up, because of these static settings and because the current set of provisioning techniques, we have generally seen that 30% of the resources are idle. They are not, although the allocations-based over-provisioning will say that most of the resources have been allocated and used, but if you measure the actual performance of the resources, we'll see that generally, the ballpark figure is around 30% of the resources are idle. Because of this, we cannot meet peak demands. So, as I said before, if there's a tenant which you have to onboard, it doesn't let you onboard them. And then we've seen resource fragmentation over a period of time. You use these static flavors, and then you, in a multi-tenanted environment, you try to spin all those VMs in a shared manner. We see that some CPU-intensive workloads are hogging that system, whereas RAM might be available, or there might be sufficient I/O available. And so performance impact due to ill-configured overcommitment ratios. This is a given. Given the current strategies, we are going to see performance impact even when you increase the over-provisioning ratios to a crazy level. There's no way to measure how it is impacting the workloads right now. And so as I said, there are hypervisor capabilities, especially with KVM, ESX, Hyper-V, which are available, which lets you do live migration, live resize in an automated manner. But those things are not there with OpenStack yet. Right. So these are the varying compute patterns we've seen. Right. So job workloads, batch job workloads, which generally run during a low peak or during the usually during nights. So those VMs, we see that there are a big inactivity period for those kind of workloads, and then there are there are certain requirements where there's a unpredictable demand. For instance, when you have a an application which you want to take it from pilot to production, there's a sudden surge of resource requirements. So generally what we do is we take that peak value and then assign those resources, assuming that those are going to be used throughout, but that's not the case with certain workloads like this. And then there's a predictable burst. The workloads which have a predictable pattern like HPC, we know when the peaks are, when the troughs are. And then in this case, again, the resource allocation becomes challenging because of the way the flavors and the quotas have to be managed in OpenStack. Right, so what are the main drivers of change, having now talked about the challenges? So these are the three main goals, which I would say that why we need to consider dynamic provisioning. So one is to optimize cost. How do you optimize cost? You reclaim unused resources, and then you consolidate workloads, and then thereby reducing the need for adding more compute resources than what is required. And then improve efficiency by right-sizing and being dynamic. So we'll show you how we right-size the VM, how we've changed the, we've added certain quotas to a flavor itself, which will allow you to play around within a set of reservations for a VM. And then being dynamic, so we have built a new API which will do a live resize of an instance. We'll show you what how we have done that. And improve utilization thereby. So we have added some new filters to the already existing scheduler filters, which will allow you to schedule based on utilization rather than allocation. And then we do a write placement. So these are all the various considerations when you are doing a performance-based cloud provisioning. You have you can do provisioning for a VM, or you could do provisioning for individual VM resources like RAM, CPU, and I/O. Then you could scale either horizontally or vertically. Sometimes both will be required to have a stable system. And then when do you take these measures? You could either be proactive. When I say proactive, you could have a modeling mechanism. You could have workload characterization, then get inputs from those workloads, and then adjust the resources accordingly, migrate or scale or do those. And then you could be reactive. You can do a performance measurement, and then whenever you see a threshold being reached for a resource, or whenever you see a swap in, swap out for memory cases, then you could act, you could add more resources to that VM. Usually there's an hybrid approach where we, the ideal scenario is where we are being both proactive and reactive. And then the decision making is measurement based and algorithms. We could apply some algorithms to all the metrics we have collected and then take a intelligent and informed decision on how we have to act when there's a resource crunch. And then the techniques are again monitoring, migration, and resizing. So these are our design philosophies. The goal for our solution was to have an optimal resource utilization with a minimal performance impact. And of course, we've tried to keep it simple. We didn't want to make too many changes, which will be difficult to maintain later. So this is how our architecture looks like. So on the left side is the controller, and then we have the compute node. So we have a stats collector which will collect both the host and the VM metrics, and then which will again send it back to a aggregator. Aggregator is a simple Python script which reads from this OpenStack bus and then puts it onto a stats DB. And then there's a resource scheduler we have built which reads data from this DB. What it does is it will keep a snapshot of instance usage and the host usage. The current snapshot of what are the utilization parameters for an instance and for a host. Right, and then so we have this policy engine and workload characterization. Workload characterization is still work in progress, but there we have a simple policy engine which governs the way you act, which will tell you when to act, how to act, and how to take countermeasures for any anomalies you have seen. So digging deeper, we see that So we have a compute, we have a controller, we have snap tasks. So for a performance measurement, you could either use Ceilometer or there are various other mechanisms out there. So we've used the Snap, which is the Intel Open Telemetry framework, right? And then we gather libvirt and the compute host parameters, and then the aggregator agent reads that, puts it on to the aggregator DB. Then there's a resource scheduler, which is, as I said, keeps polling for data, and then it acts on that. It keeps a snapshot of the current usage. Then the policies are applied, and then we call these actions based on what we have seen, based on the stat metrics and all. We either live migrate or we dynamically add vCPU or memory. So this is how the communication happens from Nova compute to libvirt, and then we maintain the action history DB. So what we have changed, so we've added a new API to resize instance on the fly. So live resize is the command. So this live resize makes use of the hypervisor functionalities for dynamically increasing memory and the vCPUs. So KVM has this feature since I think version 1.2, I believe. So it takes three arguments, which is, so for the server, we could either add vCPUs, mem, or disk. Disk is not yet implemented, but we have implemented vCPUs and memory. And then we have a new scheduler filter to provision based on utilization. There are no filters out there which will actually measure, which will actually make a scheduling decisions based on the performance metrics. So we've added this utilization filter, which is based on an allocation policy. This allocation policy does a provisioning based on the reservations set on the flavor. We'll show you how those reservations have to be set. So this is the extend reservation properties to flavors. So every flavor you have, the default allocation, what we specify to a flavor becomes the upper bound, whereas you can set a minimum reservation for every flavor. You can say that, this is the minimum memory reservation and the CPU reservation, and the other parameters become the upper bound. So it gives us this delta to play around with whenever we see there's a need to add more resources. And then we've added horizon screens to show the actual utilization. We can see those screens in our demo, which will follow. Yep, so what hypervisor functionalities we have exploited is memory ballooning. This has been there since long, but we haven't, there were no code in the Nova libvirt driver to utilize this. So we've done, so set memory is the call which actually allocates the required memory to the VM. So this is provided VM where you have to dynamically allocate memory has a memballoon driver. So by default, most of the images will have this balloon driver with them. And then we've used the set vCPUs flags function to dynamically allocate CPUs. Again, this you see the current vCPU, the current equal to 4. That's the that comes from the flavor reservation. That's what gets allocated to the VM. Whereas the upper bound here is 8. So this required again changes to the libvirt driver, and then a means for Nova to call this API. Right, so other changes which we've implemented, so we've integrated with Intel Snap for measurements. We have multiple tasks which collect the required data. We could dig into any kind of data, we can go into any depth and then take an informed decision based on those tasks. And then we have, as I've shown on the detailed architecture, we have built those aggregator agents and the resource scheduler agents. And then the Horizon UI, where we have added new pie charts, which actually shows what was allocated and what is being utilized. So this is a typical action matrix, what we've seen. So based on the symptom, what we measure and what actions we've taken based on those. So if you see a high CPU usage in the VM, so the measurement matrix is VM CPU time, and then the action we take is call that Nova live resize API to add vCPUs. Same goes for memory. If there's a high CPU, high memory usage, the measurement metrics is either it could be based on certain threshold of memory used, or it could be from if you start seeing swap in, swap out, that means it is the memory is being pressured, the pages are being swapped out. So it's time to add more memory. Again, so we use live resize to add more RAM through the balloon driver. And then there you could see a high load on the VM and high load on the host together. So that's when you do a live migrate, because you're not, the host is incapable of providing more resources to be added to the VM. So you simply live migrate to a host which is being underutilized at that time. And then high memory CPU usage on host, so you decide, live migrate bunch of VMs rather than just a single VM, which will again balance out the workloads. This will result in cost savings in terms of power as well. And then let's say there's a cool down period, there's nothing happening, there's no workloads, there's nothing running on this, and then what we do is we set the allocations to the minimum reservation which we have set on the flavor. Yep. So now, last Saurabh, to just show you the demo on what we've talked about, we'll show you two demos. Saurabh.
Thanks, Pramod. So as previously mentioned, we have added a new Nova scheduler filter, named as the utilization filter, and an allocation policy to the dynamic web provisioning. So now we're going to see how we're going to use these techniques so that we can have dynamic provisioning of VMs in order to have more VM density. So we'll start the demo now. So this is how our setup looks like. We have one controller node and two compute nodes, and we have created a particular availability zone using one compute node. And we will be using this particular flavor for spinning the VMs. This flavor will use 32 GB of RAM, 8 vCPU, and 15 GB of disk. And this is how the allocation ratio in the Nova conf looks like. This is the default one. Now we'll go to the horizon. Right, so this is how the Horizon hypervisor assembly looks like. It currently shows we don't have any instances running, and we have added the pie charts and the columns for the allocation and utilization of the RAM and the vCPUs. So now we'll go to the instance and try to spin some VMs. We'll be using the same availability zone. This is having one compute node, that is node 6. And using the same flavor, and we'll be spinning two instances here. Right, and then launch. All right, so the VMs are up now. Now, so the same has been reflected in the hypervisor summary. We can see here, it says approximately 64 GB of the RAM is being allocated out of 70 GB. However, the utilization only says 2 GB. 2 GB is being utilized, and we have two instances currently running. Now we'll go back and try to spin one more VM with the same attributes. It also need 32 GB of RAM. Right, so it fails. It fails because this flavor needs 32 GB of RAM. However, we have only approximately 6 GB of RAM is left to be allocated. So that's the problem here, which we are trying to solve. So it shows here, even the RAM utilized is only 2 GB, but since the allocated is left is very less, now only 6 GB, we will not be able to do it. So to do that, we'll be enabling our utilization filter. For that, we'll go to the NOAA conf and then change the utilization filter attribute. So here we are enabling the utilization filter at the respective lines. Yep, so this is added here in utilization filter at two lines. We'll come out of it and we'll do the restart of NOAA scheduler service. So once it is restarted, we'll go back again to the horizon and then try to spin again VM. Selecting the same attributes, same flavor of 32 GB, and here we are trying to spin two more VMs. Right, and then launch. Right, so we are able to spin two more VMs because we have taken the utilization filter into consideration, which will decide based on the utilized RAM. The same has been reflected here as well in the hypervisor summary. We can see here the RAM utilization is only 3.7 GB out of 70 GB, and we are now having the four instances running. However, we have the allocated more than that. So this is the way we try to achieve the more VM density using this utilization filter. Okay, so this concludes our first demo, which talks about the VM density. Now, we'll consider a scenario when these type of instances are up and running in this environment, and let's say the load or the resource requirement for the VM shoots up. It varies. Now, how to handle the scenario? To handle the scenario, we'll have this demo. Okay, so for this demo, we are going to use this particular type of flavor here. This flavor is exactly same. Only thing is that we have added here the reservation. We have added the memory reservation to 4 GB and CPU reservation to 4. And the total RAM remains same, 32 GB, and vCPU remains the same again, 8. This is how the NOAA conf looks like. We have the utilization filter set, and also here we have allocation policy set to be dynamic. What this allocation policy will do that, it will make sure the resource allocation will be based on the filter reservation. So this is our current setup. The horizon shows also that we have currently two instances up and running. Okay, so these are the two instances which is currently up and running, and these are spinned using the same flavor which I mentioned before. Now we'll just try to go inside the instances and see what is their stats. So we'll go to the corresponding node 6, which is hosting these two VMs. Yep, so these are the two instances which are currently up and running. So we have added these new columns, which shows the allocation and the utilization for RAM and vCPU. It says 4 GB RAM is allocated and 1.4 is being utilized. The same can be shown here in the dump XML. This is on the compute node. We can see here for this particular VM, we have 32 GB of total RAM. However, the current says only 4 GB, and similarly for the for CPU also, the current is 4. Now what we do, we'll log into one of the instances and try to increase the CPU memory utilization. We'll be using stress command to increase the memory utilization. So this will increase the memory utilization. As the memory utilization increases, our scheduler agent sitting behind will keep monitoring it. And once it reaches one threshold, it'll take the necessary resize action. So here we can see the free, which is going down. We are checking is using VM stat is suddenly going up. It means that the resize has happened and we have now more RAM available. We can again verify the same with the dump XML. If you just check, initially it was showing current as in 4 GB, now it's changed to 6 GB. So it has been resized using the agent. The same has been reflected in the hypervisor as well. So here the horizon also says that reflect the same thing, it is having the 6 GB now. Previously it was 4, and the utilization is 3.5 GB of RAM. Right, so we're gonna perform the same exercise for the CPU as well. For the CPU also, if we do the dump XML, we'll see here the current is only 4. However, the total is having 8. We'll go inside one of the instance and check the LSCPU output. This also says the same thing. We have the four vCPUs currently allocated. Now here also we'll run the same thing. We'll try to use the stress to increase the CPU utilization. So here using stress, using this command, we are increasing the CPU utilization. So as the CPU utilization again increases to one particular threshold, the resource scheduler will kick in and do the resize, live resize. Right, so even we can check the same thing in the compute log. We see the live resize API has been kicked in and the vCPU has been changed to 6. Right, the LSCPU output has also been changed. Now it's showing 6, initially it was 4. Right, so we'll just finally verify at the horizon. Here the vCPU was initially 4, now it's being bumped up to 6, and the CPU utilization is close to 23.35%. The same thing can be verified on the dump XML as well. Yes, so if you do the dump XML, initially it was showing current as in 4, now it has been changed to 6. So this is the way live resize is done. So this is the way we do the dynamic resize through using these introduced parameters. That concludes our demo. Back to Kamal. Thanks.
Few more slides which I'll quickly go through. So I'll just rush through here. This shows the density graph, what we have seen when we have enabled utilization filters and the live resize. So when you set the allocation policy to dynamic and provisioning based on utilization, we are able to achieve much more density, what we have seen, and thereby we have reduced the number of underutilized systems. So this is our future development. We plan to work with with the community to integrate our code. We'll plan to make that upstream. Then we'll see if we are trying to work with Intel to have a workflow engine, and then we'll integrate probably with Congress or something to have a policy engine. Evaluate workload characterizations to do modeling, fine-grained monitoring. So, and then storage monitoring as well. So key takeaways, we don't need to set the static over-provisioning ratios anymore. We've seen that using the performance metrics, you can do a right sizing and right allocation without having to, without impacting the performance of the VMs. Then we've seen how we have maximized the resource utilization non-intrusively. Previously, flavor resize would have, had to shut down the VM automatically, and then there's a disruption to the workloads. Now with this new API, you don't need to do that. You can do vertical scaling to a bit where you can play around from the minimum reservation to the maximum upper limit. Beyond that, you can always do a live migration and then or horizontal scaling. So no great engineering required. It was all there. We just added code to stitch together things. Okay, some things to note. So as I said before, there are some prerequisites. This might not fit all. You need to think. You need to take certain things into considerations, like the guest VMs need to have this chemo guest agent, which will actually act when you issue this live resize command. Then there's a pneuma topology. You cannot just add vCPUs when you have asked, from a flavor which we want to spin based on specific pneuma topology. So right now we don't do any live resize if you have enabled pneuma topology. We'll have to go see how those things can be taken into consideration when we work with community to upstream this. Then there's same things have to be considered for vCPU pinning and placements. Memory backed by huge pages. Again, we don't act if the memory, guest VM memories are backed by huge pages right now. CPU tune, mem tune parameters exist in the worst dump XML. Then again, we don't do any live resizing. Then this might again impact your metering billing because of the way the allocation changes. It might impact your existing systems. Yep, so that's it. All right. Thank you. Thanks again. Questions?
Do you do any capacity planning, and how do the live adjustments impact your capacity planning?
Yeah, so that's one of the biggest advantages we have seen from this solution. It gives us a right picture on what exactly, what is the capacity being used right now, rather than what is being allocated, which might be for a future use. But then the reports we gather out of the metrics collected gives you a picture on the exact utilization. Again, it doesn't predict the capacity requirements in future, but gives you a dashboard kind of a thing where you can see, at a fine-grained level, how much of the RAM, CPU, and IO are being utilized, and then you get the idea on what to add. When there's a peak demand.
Okay. So as far as deterministic capacity planning and your level of elasticity going forward, are you able to predict the levels of elasticity you need for growth, say 20% on either side? What is your churn rate now that you know your utilization? What are you seeing as far as elasticity?
So I think we've not gone, this system has to run over a period of time for us to get those numbers. So we've been running this in production for a much lesser time. I don't think we have got to that point where we can deterministically say that this is going to be our elasticity going forward. But I think the data is there. We just need to put together things and show that number. Sorry?
The CPU run utilization metric may be from the
Can they be created? Yeah. So, So you can use that Nova Live Resize API. So we have integrated that with the Python Nova client. You can use the Python Nova client APIs to tweak it.
Is there a way to test this on GitHub or something?
So I forgot to add that link on the GitHub. It has there's an internal GitHub. I'll post it when the video goes online. I think it should be when we give this presentation online. I think you should see that on the. I'll put that references chart with the GitHub link. You can pull that code and test it out.
Less relevant?
Yeah, so, right, so the inflexibility of the flavors led us to develop such a solution. I don't think they have become less relevant. They still give you, the limits for the VM to be set, but again, there are certain limitations with the current solution where you cannot change the upper boundary in a live manner. That still requires a reboot of the VMs. So
it sounds like you're removing the onus on the application owner to pick the right flavor,
right.
And you're just compensating for their lack of knowledge or experience by then resizing for them. So would you ever consider just having one basic flavor, like a medium flavor, and then your process will move it anywhere that needs to be moved. I'm just wondering, just thinking in the future.
Yeah, so we could get there, but I think there are still workloads which still they ask for a minimum set of requirements. So how do you set that minimum? Right, the upper bound we can just grow beyond, but when a customer says, I still need my 8 GB of RAM upfront. So we still need to honor those requests. So that's where I think flavors will stay, but the elasticity might increase. There might not be, the medium flavor could be an upper limit flavor where we can see that all these VMs can use up to these resources, which still could be unlimited as well.
So when they say, like you said, you need a minimum of 8 GB of RAM,
and you're doing utilization on their apps, and let's just say it's a WordPress app, and it's across your whole enterprise, would you still give that to them, or you would course correct them to get a different flavor,
no.
Or you would just continue in the operation you're doing
now?
Yeah,
so this minimum is guaranteed reservation, and we bill for that. We are getting money for that, despite even when they're not using. So minimum is something which they ask for. We have to honor that. That's why the flavors will continue to have that, whereas we can give them reports and charts and say that not utilizing those, and then if they say yes, based on some approval process, we can scale it down.
So first of all, thanks a lot, because it was very interesting. The question is, do you plan to combine this with auto-scaling capacities or horizontal auto-scaling? And if so, how do you see all this automation happening at the same time?
So you mean horizontal scaling?
Yes, in Heat, for example.
Okay, so yeah, we can consider that. We haven't given that thought yet. So good point. So probably we can work on this and see how we'll interact, how we will integrate with a Heat or a Murano kind of orchestration. Yeah. Can you please repeat that?
When you over provision, let's say basically you hosted 20 VMs over the same host, and their utilization is correlated, so they all see the peak at the same time. Does your system break, or how do you handle that type of correlated workload situations?
Yeah, so we've built some basic correlation engine with our resource agent, which will, so if you've seen that architecture, we get the data, you know, the resource agent gets the data from the NovaDB itself, which it knows that these 20, these set of VMs belong to this set of tenants, and then they are governed by certain policies at a VM level, at a tenant level, and then at a broader global level. And then, so based on these metrics, we can act as per the policies. I don't think we can make a decision on entirely based on metrics. It has to be governed by policies. Did I answer your question?
No, not quite, so but we can take it offline.
Yeah, make sure. Okay. Yep. Thank you.
All right.
Okay, thank you, folks.
Yeah, thanks.